You know, maybe I had a question about something that happened in the very end. So how is it you explained that you get G-star together with its KK as Poisson bracket, and how is it the level K doesn't play any role? Is it right?
Ah, that's a very good question. Here, for the universal, what I call universal is this one. You notice that it's pretty surprising. The EAG you obtain does not depend on K. So maybe here you have this. And indeed, this does not depend on K. But now I'm turning this simple quotient because I haven't said, but this vertex algebra is very important for representation theory of Katz-Moody algebra. And in representation theory, what we like is to understand simple modules. So I'm now taking a simple quotient. And then in this setting, it will strongly depend. And it will be the same in W algebras. So precisely, now I consider the unique simple quotient. So here, you can wonder which simple it is. So there is a notion of simple modules over a vertex algebra and then ideals and simple in this sense. But it's also simple as a G hat module. In fact, there is a correspondence between a VKG module, so I don't give the definition of module over vertex algebras, but it is the same as a representation of G hat, so let's say M, such that XTM, NM, is 0 for N beginner. You say this is a smooth representation. So you have a correspondence, and so simple is simple in both sense, so it's no problem. And actually, as a G hat representation, this simple quotient is a highest raised representation. For those who know, otherwise you can just forget. Huh? So this is a highest raised representation of G hat. So okay, let's consider that. So it is a quotient. And then one can wonder what is the associated variety of that. So this is in general very hard to compute. What we can say is because of this quotient, one can show that this is a sub-variety of G star. Maybe I like to identify G star with G using this scalar product. And also, it's Poisson by construction, so in fact, it is G invariant. So there is an action on the group, and it is G invariant. It is also closed, and it's conical. There is an action of this type. But it is the only general thing we can say, and we can compute only for some particular level. The level, it, K, it is what we call the level. So I would like to give example where we know how to compute this. So for those who know a variety associated with primitive ideals, this should play similar roles. But I'm not sure you are familiar with this, so I don't explain. So examples where we can compute. So first of all, it is well known that I don't know in which direction, but it's equivalent. So, if this one is an integrable G hat representation, so I don't know if you are familiar with that. So, if you are not, it's just equivalent to the fact here that K is a non-negative integer. Then, it's known that the associated variety is just zero. So one direction is easier to show and the other is also true. So this is the only case where this is just a point. And I have, as I have said, this implies very strong properties of the variety, of the vertex algebras. It means in particular there are only finitely modules over the vertex algebra, for instance. Okay, so this is one family, and there is a bigger family. So there is a general notion of integrable representation, and there is a much larger family of admissible representation. So this definition is not so pleasant, it's purely combinatorial, so in terms of root system of G hat. So I don't give the definition, but conjecturally, it's due to Katz and Wakimoto, and conjecturally they correspond to those representations whose character satisfies a certain modular invariance property.
Excuse me, you said that it incorporates properties of a vertex algebra, which one? So
So in fact, if you have this, I just simplify to say it's a point. I assume that my vertex algebra is positively graded, so it's fine. So if you have this, it is what V is called this. And it implies, for instance, that there is only finitely many simple V modules. So this is already very strong. And moreover, assume that your vertex algebra, which is the case in our example, is positively graded, like this. You can define a normalized character, which is a kind of trace. But there is a, maybe I write just like this. So you have this, and then there is a shift. Okay, I assume conformal, there is a constant, but anyway, it's a kind of trace. And Q here is exponential 2i pi tau, and tau runs through the Poincaré half plan. And here, SL2, so you have finitely many of them. So let's say M1, MS. So now you can consider the vector span. So you can do for modules. Here I do for V, but you can do also for modules. And then you can take the vector span generated by that. And then, so what I'm saying is not exactly true, you need another assumption, but anyway, SL2Z acts on this, so this is very strong. So this is not totally right if I only have this, but at least if you act on one character, it spans a finite dimensional vector space. So anyway, the condition you obtain is in this setting about characters and finiteness of modules. So this is very nice.
So that's like rationality.
Yeah, exactly. In fact, to be totally correct, I need to assume rationality. But what is very present is that without rationality, you still have this, and you still have a weaker statement, but very close. And there is a conjecture that rationality implies this. So it's connected. So this kind of property you get.
I'm sorry, I'm a bit lost. So what happened? What is rationality?
Okay, I did not want to
what
say.
What is rational?
Okay, rational is, but I didn't say what is module. But anyway, is when any graded modules is completely reducible. Completely reducible.
That's rational in which sense?
Okay, the term rational comes from the fact that in this case, okay, I haven't explained central charge.
So it's not the variety is rational.
The central charge is rational number, to be sure.
So it's not the variety that is rational.
No. Okay. It's very confusing. And also, list is very confusing in French because the variety is not smooth. So, okay, sorry for the notation. It's not me. So rationality, this is this kind of properties, but okay. But at least you see these kind of things. But of course, as you can imagine, this is a very strong condition. So that's why
here we have
This one is not at all this. This kind of thing you can. It's difficult to imagine. V is not simple.
Yeah, but we see the explicit elements of the vertex algebra, how they are in this Verma module, what they are.
Yeah, but here it's this is you don't have so much chance except if K is generic.
Okay.
In this case, if k is generic, that means not rational number, this one coincides with its simple quotient. But outside this, it, you cannot hope to have a strong condition for. Is it? But yeah, this is why we, at the beginning, we study this variety to study this kind of condition, which are easier to study as rationality as soon as you can compute. So precisely, this is very strong. And then we want to enlarge, and precisely I will go back to a larger and explain we have similar things. So, okay, so I don't, in this talk I don't want to talk too much about representation theory things, but just believe me that there is a larger class, and for example, this one is admissible in the sense of Kato-Akimoto if and only if, so we have a just condition on k. K must be a rational number of this form, minus HH plus P over Q, where PQ are coprime, and P is greater than the dual coxeter number if Q, okay, let's say if G has type ADE, for instance. And maybe I don't give a general definition. Okay. Otherwise, you have you can have another condition, but it's enough for this. All right, so in this case, so in particular, if k is just a non-negative integer, it is admissible. And then, what is, for admissible k, it was proved by Arakawa that we know how to compute the associated variety. So here, so if k is admissible, so let's say of this form, then this one is contained in the nilpotent cone, but it's even better than this. It's a closure of some nilpotent orbit. So in particular, it is in the nilpotent cone, and for some nilpotent orbit, okay. And you can describe it explicitly. I will go back at the end in application, but it's known in exceptional and classical types. So it's very nice. You see in particular, this is irreducible. It's contained in the nilpotent cone. So you see it's a Poisson variety, but with only finitely many symplectic leaves in particular. So in particular, and in fact, when we have this, we have, it's not so nice, but similar. You have to restrict your set of modules here. Here it's just solution of modular linear equation, but anyway, you have similar things when your variety has finitely many symplectic leaves, so this is already very nice. And this was conjectured by Fegin and Frenkel, and it was also conjectured that if you have this, this is contained in the nilpotent cone, then k has to be admissible. But with Arakawa, we found new examples, and which are interesting for the reason. So maybe I give just some examples. I don't give the complete statement. So other examples, still in this setting, I take for g either d4, either e6, e8, e7, e8, and for k, it is minus 2 for d4, minus 3, minus 4, minus 6. So what we, you don't care about the number, but just it is not admissible. So it does not, it's not included in this part. And then we show with Arakawa that in this case, the associated variety is a minimal nilpotent orbit closure that we encountered before, corresponding to your Lie algebra. So in particular, this is contained in the nilpotent cone. So It's not nice because it does not give a geometrical characterization of admissible level, but it's very nice for applications because this gives new example where we have this condition that we have in particular finitely many symplectic loops. Okay, so now I would like to discuss compatibility with BRST reduction, and so we go to the topic of W algebras. I want to give another, in fact, larger family of examples. Okay, so, in fact, I'm talking about double algebras. So here, I'm sorry, I don't give definitions because it's a bit too technical. But, okay, I keep the same notation, but now I fix a nilpotent element in my Lie algebra. And again, a k is a complex number. And then I denote by WKGF the universal W algebra associated with G and F at level k. So what is that? So it's some vertex algebra which is constructed by taking a certain zero cohomology group applied to this vertex algebra. In fact, you have to tensorize with another one, but maybe I don't explain this. I just write this functor like this. It is a particular case of BRST reduction. So I just write like this, and maybe for short, S0F. So you have a complex, and it is it's a general fact. And if you have the quotient of kernel by image with some conditions, this has a vertex algebra structure. This is a general fact. What I want to say? Yeah, so here, first of all, if f is zero, you recover the universal affine vertex algebra. So this is a generalization. And for those who know, if G is SL2 and f is non-zero, so let's say this one, you recover a Virasoro vertex algebra. So I haven't explained this example, but this is also a famous class of vertex algebras. And CK, of course, is connected to K in some sense. So this family of vertex algebras includes these two famous families. Family of vertex algebras, but this one in general is not generated by Lie algebras. So to study them, you need the formalism of vertex algebras. For the previous example, in fact, you can study most properties I explained using Kac-Moody algebras. You don't really need this difficult formalism. All right, so now how this is connected with Slodovich slides and nilpotent Slodovich slides. So there is a result of Katz and de Solé that the associated virality of the universal one is exactly the nilpotent, the Slodovich slice we encounter. So here again, it does not depend on k. So what I'm saying is that in fact the associated virality of this one is this nilpotent Slodovich slice I introduced at the beginning of my talk. And so here the Poisson structure comes from, in fact, Z1 of G star, identified with G, using a certain Hamiltonian reduction. And the key point to relate is that, in fact, you can describe the coordinate ring of that using also a BRST reduction, which is a slightly, of course, it's different context, but similar construction, and here the Poisson algebra involved in this one. So intuitively, it is a natural affinization of this one. Okay, so here again, you see, it does not depend on K. But now, again, we are mostly interested in simple quotients. And here again, this is a priori.
Sorry, those Poisson structures on the slot of a slice, are they often zero or are they often non-zero? Or how is it?
It's non-zero. In fact, here it's easy to describe it. Maybe it's not easy if I don't want to introduce notation, but symplectic leaves are just intersection of this with this G.
With what? With what?
It's just intersection of this with symplectic leaves of G.
Okay.
So it's not trivial.
Or trivial.
Trivial, but in fact, okay, you can have this is a kind of quotient of some group like this, and you can describe the bracket using that group. So it depends on what is here, but.
But like say, for principle.
Principle is trivial.
Yeah, then it's zero.
That's why in the introduction lecture of Arakawa, it's good, but in some sense, I don't really like because it's precisely trivial for Poisson thing. But it's already interesting.
Okay.
But yeah, that example is trivial precisely because of this. But in general, it's not. Yeah. Okay, so here again, I consider a simple quotient of that. And you see the advantage of this construction is functorial. So you can apply this to a module over that. So in particular, it makes sense to apply this to a simple quotient, the simple quotient of that. So unfortunately, here it's difficult to compute, but what we know by a result of Arakawa again, is that this one is just the intersection of this variety with nilpotent slot of a slice. So this is very nice because as soon as you know that, you know this one. And now the simple quotient is not a priori equal to that, but certainly it is a quotient of that as soon as this one is non-zero. And actually, conjecturally, they are the same, and in many cases it is proved. So for the talk, you can think we know that, as soon as we know that. Huh? So the philosophy, anyway, in general, this is a quotient, but as soon as you know that, you have already many information. For instance, if this is a point, this one is this. If this one is contained in the nilpotent cone, this one is a vertex algebra whose associated varieties has only finitely many symplectic leaves. So this is a BRST compatibility with associated variety, which is very nice. So for example, if K is admissible, what you get, this is, and now we go to nilpotent Sodovy slice. If K, if J is D4, E6, E7, E8, and the level is as before in our theorem, you get this intersection. And here it either this, either the, what I want to say? It's just a point or it is this closure. Because in Omin there is, in the closure of Omin, there is just Omin and zero. Okay, so this is how nilpotent Slodovy slices appears in this context. Is it okay? Okay, so I think I finished with examples. So now I would like to give motivation from physics and then explain the problem we studied. Okay, so here, I just explain motivation, but I spent too much time. So this is the last part about the problem, and I start with some motivations. So recently a group of physicists
So it's a big group, but including Beam and Rastelli. So the year is about 16. They introduced a remarkable map from four-dimensional n equals to two superconformal field theories, whatever it means, to two-dimensional conformal field theories. So that is to say, vertex algebras. So essentially, they restrict the dimension by two. They restrict to some operators, and they get this map. So let's say it's fine. And this map is supposed to enjoy nice properties. And the idea is that if you want to understand some invariants or observables here, you can recover this by taking some corresponding invariants at the vertex algebra site. So, and then this map is very interesting to understand both sides of the theory. Sometimes from physicist prediction we get information here, and conversely, sometimes we can prove mathematically some physical predictions. So this map is supposed to satisfy, so maybe because I introduce a normalized character, you have a notion of Schur index here. I don't have so much idea of what it is, but it is a certain Q series. This should correspond to the normalized character I have explained before. These kind of things you have. You have also, for instance, there is a notion of central charge here. And here I explain there is a, okay, here I assume it is a vertex operator algebra, so this means you have an action on V Razolo, and then you have a certain central charge. I forgot the relation, but what is interesting, maybe it's 12. It's not so important. What is important is that in physics, this is always assumed to be strictly positive. So this one, this mean is always strictly negative. So this means this map is far from being surjective. You cannot get favorite vertex algebras because of this condition, for instance. Okay, so now, so this is rather numerical invariant, but there is also an important geometrical invariant called the Higgs branch. Conjecturally correspond to the associated variety. Okay, so now conjecture, so by Beam and Rastelli, is that for any such theories, then what we call the Higgs branch is equal to the associated variety of the corresponding vertex algebra, and as a reduced scheme. So this is very interesting. So a priori, this is a possibly singular symplectic variety. So just think of the closure of some one symplectic leaves. But here, remember, that this is only Poisson varieties. So this means that according to the physicist conjecture, the vertex algebras appearing in this correspondence are very special. And in fact, it is even conjectured by physicists that this one has only finitely many symplectic leaves. So physicists predict that has finitely many symplectic leaves, and that in fact it is the closure of one of them. It's also irreducible. So this means that vertex algebras are supposed to verify these properties, and this is one of the reasons This class of vertex algebras is very interesting for us, even if we studied this rather for representation theory motivations at the beginning. But now it's become a very nice motivation. And the main example considered by this physicist is the following. They observe that these vertex algebras that appear in our theorem with Arakawa, So these appear as vertex algebras in this correspondence. So they are image of some theories, but of course T change for all the three. Okay, so these appear in this correspondence. So remember, this is non-admissible simple vertex algebras. They are the a priori most exotic one. And then for them, a physicist proved, I don't know if I can say prove, but show, observe, that the each branch is exactly the minimal nilpotent orbit closure. And our result with Arakawa shows that this is precisely the associated variety. So this conjecture is known for this example. And this is the main example that they obtained to formulate this. And now this was proved by Arakawa in a special distinguished class of this four-dimensional conformal field theories called classes. And so this is included in these classes. But in general, it's fairly open. So this is one thing. And now, W algebras at admissible levels appear in this story. So
I somehow missed this. So what is what did Arakawa prove?
It's not nice. I did that. So Arakawa prove the conjecture for classes theory, which is a part of this whole theories.
And what is Higgs tau?
Yeah, that's the point. In this case, it was proved by Braverman, Finkelberg, and Nakajima that this has a mathematical definition. So he used the mathematical definition to prove the statement. Otherwise, it has no really mathematical meanings to show that. So. Okay, so now there is also, I don't know if it is distinguished class because I think, another class because I think there is an intersection with that, but anyway, there is also what is called Argyras-Douglas theory. So this is also part of that, let's say. And here, typical, I don't claim it's all, but typical example of phi of t, for t in this special class of theories, are W algebras with k admissible, but special admissible, it's when p is as small as possible. So you remember your denominator has to be greater than hh, but here it's boundary, it's as small as possible. And for g, they consider mainly type AD. Okay, so this is how they appear in this context. And now what is very interesting is that sometimes you may have a non-trivial isomorphism between two W algebras. I mean differently algebras, different F and different level. And sometimes this happens because two theories which are the same theories has different realizations. So sometimes this kind of isomorphism come from physical predictions. Sometimes just mathematical, but there are many examples like this, but it's just physical observation and it's nice to have a proof of such things. Also for the reason, it's natural to search a simple one, if you. So in particular, sometimes you have the situation that one real W algebras is isomorphic to an affine one. So in other words, it's when f prime is zero here. And in such situation, K is called collapsing. And this is what we want to classify. So this is too optimistic to classify all levels for which we have this. So we do some particular cases. Is it okay? So this is just motivation. And now I would like to give a more precise definition of collapsing level and explain some of our results. And some of our results confirm physical prediction. And of course, when you have this, associated varieties has to be the same. So this means that if you start with the singularities of nilpotent Sludovic slice, and if you know that we have non-trivial isomorphism between nilpotent Sludovic slice, you can expect something. This is the idea. Okay, so I just make more sense here. For instance, what is G prime, what is K prime, etc. So yeah, so I need to introduce some notation. So I denote by G natural the centralizer of my SL2 triple in G. So you remember this generates a Lie algebra of type SL2, and you can look at the centralizer of this, and it is well known that G natural is a reductive Lie algebra. Alright? And now Katz and Wakimoto show that there is a kind of action of the vertex algebra, affine vertex algebras of G natural on the W algebras. At the level, okay, I write and I explain geometrically at least. So you have an embedding, more precisely, of this inside this. So here where K natural is determined entirely by K and F. There is a formula, it's a polynomial in K, it's determined by their work, and okay.
So actually, this is a kind of Lie of algebra inside.
Exactly. So in fact, geometrically, if you think on Sludovic slice, so G natural, you have the Hadron group. This group acts. It acts on a nilpotent orbit. It acts on nilpotent Sludovic slice. So it acts on the intersection. And in fact, there is a lifting of that.
It preserves the slice.
Exactly. It preserves the slice. So if you think this is an affinization of that, you have a kind of lifting of that. And the level here, you have no choice. To make a vertex algebra homomorphism, you have to fix the level. This is the idea. And now the definition, which is due to Adamovich, Katz, and collaborators. There are many of them, so I'm sorry for them. We say that K is collapsing if, so now I compose this map, so this embedding with a natural projection over the quotient, and you recognize that the component map is surjective. And one can show that this is equivalent to the fact that the simple quotient is isomorphic to the simple quotient of this universal affine vertex algebra. So you recover this kind of condition, but just it makes more precise what is the candidate here. You have no choice. So this.
I have some general confusion, but. So how, so a priori, of course, this variety is gene variant. That's where we started, right?
Which one?
Well, the X, XL.
Yeah, in this setting, you have to be careful. You talk about W algebra?
No, so let's just talk for L, for the Lie algebra.
This one is Lie invalid, yes.
Right. So then there is this thing, at some point you say, okay, then we do this BRST thing and then we intersect it with the Slodovy slice. Of course, the Slodovy slice is never gene variant.
Exactly.
So when you're checking this, yeah, but when you check it, so this cannot come, for example, from one. And then when you are checking these conditions, so it's somehow you reduce the algebra, or what is, so it's a small algebra, of course, here. So here this is an apparent contradiction, but.
No, I think the confusion is that when we go to W algebra, then it no longer needs to be
Of course, it cannot be. So, but what I'm trying to say now, so that's just an apparent.
Okay. But,
but here it is something. So,
exactly.
So that's what I'm trying
exactly,
to understand.
But be careful. It is exactly what I'm going to explain. Yes, because I'm going to explain that.
Just to make sure, but. Here you're saying that somehow accidentally or not accidentally,
yes.
The symmetry and the small.
This is difficult. So first of all, let me just finish with this definition. Of course, as you can imagine, most of K are not collapsing. This is a very strong condition, precisely because what you say. It means that geometrically, if K is admissible, a nilpotent Slodovy slice has to be isomorphic to a nilpotent orbit closure in a smaller algebra. And this is precisely where we use work of crash processes and so on, because we understand singularity, so we can eliminate most of cases. This is what we do. But say, just one remark is that Adamovich, Katz, and so on complete the classification for the case where F is in the minimal nilpotent orbit. And the reason is here, the OPE are known. And in general, it's not so, it's very difficult to adapt their work. So in general, it's difficult to first detect candidate. So now, to study other cases, the idea is that if so, if K is collapsing, and for simplicity, I assume K admissible, because in general, we don't know how to compute the associated variety. Then, obviously, associated variety has to be the same. So this means that you have a coincidence between these objects with, so assume that K and K natural is admissible. In fact, this implies you have this. And this is a strong condition, very strong condition. Strong. So the idea is we use the work of these people to first see what we can study. So I explain in SLN what we do, because it's quite nice. It is a kind of recipe by Kraft and Procesi to tell us when this has a chance to be true. So I give an illustrating example, and I think after I can stay just for a second. So let's take, so first of all SLN, and I remind you that nilpotent orbit, I have a bit explained at the beginning, are in one-to-one correspondence with partition of N, using the Jordan blocks. Huh? So for a partition here, I associate, I denote by O lambda the corresponding nilpotent orbit. Now, if K is admissible, it has the following form. Huh? The dual Coxeter number is just this. So you have K of this form. This is one, and a priori is P, and P is greater than N. All right. And by Arakawa result, I can tell you what is OK. OK is correspond to this partition, like this, where this is the Euclidean division of N by Q. You take the maximal. So this means it's a maximal rectangular one you can make. So here you have M, Q, and sometimes it's not rectangular, so you have the rest. This is the maximal rectangular partition you can make into M. This is the result of Arakawa. It tells us that. So I remember that if you take the closure, this the meaning is that it is the associated variety of that. All right. So now what I want to do? I want to study this kind of condition. So I pick an element F in the closure. And I want to understand, I call it that, but I did not the corresponding partition by mu. So mu is in the degeneracy of that. Huh? And then I would like to understand this. So F, but I put mu to refer the partition. And now there is a beautiful removal common rules by Kraft and Procesi that I illustrate on a special case where n is 7 and q is 3. Okay, I assume n to be 7, q is 3, so lambda is 3, 3, 1, so I can represent my partition like this, and then I take for f, for instance, I will take mu to be 3, 1, 4. So here I represent lambda, I represent mu. So here in fact what I want is that. Huh? So think of this as associated variety of some, so q is 3, SL 7, F, mu. Okay, you can think of that. And the rule of Kraft-Procesi says that this nilpotent Lodovich slice is the same. So their statement is just smooth equivalence, but as I say, now it is proved that it is really as algebraic variety, is the same as if you erase the common rows. So here, 3 is in commons. So you erase, and what you get is a new nilpotent Lodovich slice, but in a smaller Lie algebra, in a smaller SLN. So here you have the partition 3, 1, and here you have the partition 1, 4 in SL4. And of course I didn't choose arbitrary F. I choose F so that this one is in fact a zero nilpotent orbit. So then what I get is that this is just the closure of this one. So I am happy, because in this example, we can prove that G natural is C cross SL4. So this example, now I can interpret this using again Arakawa result as the associated variety of something like that, P prime over 3 of SL4.
So C because it has a center, right? Or
yeah, it's because it has a center. In general, in most of cases, it's just semi-simple.
Yeah, yeah. But the more like plus, right? Or
There is a center. Yeah. It's not a big trouble. Okay, so of course the geometry. So here it's associated variety. That the geometry is not enough, but from that one can wonder this: if this geometrical interpretation has a lifting, do we have that this SL7F is isomorphic to this one? So here we have no choice. For instance, computing the central charge, we observe that it's possible only if P is 7 and 4 here, and the answer is yes. But of course, geometry is not enough to prove that. We use different methods. Actually, we use this normalized character. But the geometry is very helpful to find candidates.
This is the point. So I will conclude with our theorem. So I don't state all cases, but it's not important.
important for you to have exhaustive list, but just to see how it looks for SNL
at least. And then I comment some open problems related to that. So our theorem, so this is in common with Arakawa and Van Eekhen. So I give the statement for SLN and just a particular case. So I explained already how we choose K. So a priori it is of this form. And our result, one part says that we have the following isomorphism. With minus S plus S over Q, SLF. So I have to say what is
not 7, right? Any
no, sorry, yeah, first of all this is N, F. I pick F in the following partition, but here it's confusing because it's not the Euclidean division. So maybe I change my, yeah, it does not appear, so it's okay. It's not N, it's not good. R, okay. 1, S, like this. And S, S is S. Okay. So it's like this, and here again you see, I will choose so that it remains only.
Or is it Q times R plus S is N?
Yeah, it's a partition. So, yeah. But I am just thinking whether R, don't think I need.
So, and you say it's not Euclidean division because.
Yeah,
S,
yeah, I'm thinking.
Because S might be.
Big. Yeah, exactly. But R at least has to be bigger, smaller than M. M is chosen Euclidean division. So, to say, you remember, you have your rectangular maximal. And sorry, S is not the same, so maybe T. Yeah, sorry. So you have this, and I choose F. I don't need exactly the same. I can choose smaller and then 1. I can take the same, but it's more general than this. Mm-hmm. And then we have more cases, but maybe I don't describe. It's not so interesting for you, but we have conjecturally an exhaustive list of admissible collapsing levels for SLN and all types, actually. So what is very interesting here is that you notice that this is boundary admissible. So this is minimal one and minimal one here. And this was actually was conjectured by physicists. It appears in this Algeras Douglas theory. So this gives a mathematical meaning of this. And so we have similar statements. Similar statement for all types. So in type exceptionals, of course, it's given not in terms of partition, but in terms of the Balla-Carter classification. So it's just tables. And we conjecture this gives the exhaustive list of admissible collapsing level. Well, in exceptional cases, up to our mistake, it should be true because we check all cases. In exceptional cases, it's not clear because it's not clear that Kraft-Plochesi rule is exhaustive. We have this rule, but maybe there are some kind of isomorphism which don't come from this rule. Okay, so I would like to finish just with a comment. Maybe I don't explain the proof, but the proof is totally different. It's rather, we have a strong result which says that if we can prove that normalized characters are the same, then we have the isomorphism. And the key point is that we have a combinatorial formula for normalized characters, so we compute. This is a bit bothering at the end, but this is a reciprocal which allows us to check. But to find candidates, we proceed like that. Second thing, As I say, maybe it's not interesting for you, I give example, because probably you don't know what is known about nilpotent slow-Dowie slice in exceptional cases, but sometimes we get, I think, new isomorphism between nilpotent slow-Dowie slice and nilpotent orbit closure in orderly algebras. And last remark, interesting to consider non-admissible. So this is converse. Here, physicists have prediction and we don't know how to prove. And conversely, we have examples which, for instance, in non-simply lace case, which are not a priori physical limit. Admissible levels. So we have a number of conjectures and some of them we just have proved recently. But, okay, maybe I don't give that. And second interesting problems. So you remember, I start with, in fact, a more general problem like this. In fact, I restricted to this case, but we can wonder in general how to do that. So again, geometrically, it corresponds to isomorphism between nilpotent slow-Dowie slices. And we feel that this could be related to the BRST reduction by steps, in the sense that sometimes we can do a first reduction and go to a shape like this, and apply again. And then we hope this is the same process as doing once. And in sometimes we have such a thing. So I just take one conjecture, which is not a conjecture, but I will explain. So just one. Did I write this conjecture? Yeah. So it's similar to the previous example. So, but here I take F to be 3, 2, 2. I don't take 3, 1, 1, 1, 1. And then we conjecture again from geometry that this is this one. SL4 with F prime using 2. So I finish with that. I explain the process and explain you that here we can do in two steps. So in fact, it's not really a conjecture, but more generally with any F, we can conjecture that. So I draw again the picture. So I start with 3 to, so this is the associated variety here. And now I intersect with 3, 2, 2. So, okay, in fact, for prosthesis, there is also common rules, but I don't apply this for the moment. If I erase this, I don't use colon, but here you notice colon also. So here I obtain this one. This one, so a priori it's non-trivial. So you can interpret as this one. This is the reason. But now it turns out that the rules also work for colon. So now you can do either you do these steps and then you get, in fact, this is just a nilpotent cone of SL2. And then we get something like this. Or you can do this rule directly from this one. And then you get also that. So, in fact, this conjecture is okay in this case because you can do it in two steps or applying both twice our theorem and then it's okay. But now if you take any f and any f prime, it's really a conjecture. So this is the next thing we can study using this. And I think I'll stop with that.
Thank you.
Just when you mentioned the proof, of course, you said, oh, it's really actually very simple. We just take the characters, we compare them, and
yeah, it's not simple.
Well, what's wrong here? I mean, here you just take the same way you take characters, you compare them, and you're done.
Ah, here, no, because you're right. But in fact, the proof is more complicated than this. In fact, we don't really use characters. This is too hard to compute. We use asymptotic behavior. And we need that one of the sides is a simple affine. You look.
I'm listening.
We need in the proof that one part is a simple affine one.
In fact, what we prove is, it's rather we compare this one with this one. So this is embarrassing because we don't have the conjecture that this is equal to the simple quotient, but we can prove at the end that if we have this,
the simple quotient here
is isomorphic to this one. Yeah, somewhere in the proof we cannot we need that this one comes from VK natural. Unfortunately, of course, this is how we formulate the conjecture. We check the character and we think it works similarly, but the proof doesn't work similarly. And again, you can say, okay, it works for non-admissible, but we use in the proof, and also we don't know how to compute normalized character in general. So this is another reason we.
So I have another one. So, so of course, there isn't a correspondence backwards. So you can have the same variety for different modules, like for LK, right? But is there some slice of the theory when you can actually try to say that this variety determines
the
vertex operator algebra?
You may have different vertex algebras with the same associated variety, and in our story, of course, in most of cases, we don't have lifting.
Sometimes we have an isomorphism between nilpotent slice and so on, but it's not always possible to lift.
Sometimes just checking central charge will have no solutions.
This was my question, actually, sort of. But
yeah, it's a nice invariant, but you lose a lot of information.
As you notice, there is no central charge, no level, so you cannot hope it works. So.
Okay, more questions?
So you said the physicist predicted that a Higgs branch has finitely many symplectic leaves. Are there examples where we can see this happening?
Of course, they don't exactly formulate like this, but we can interpret like this. You mean other example of Higgs branch?
A simple example where we can see this.
Yeah, there is a very nice example.
For instance, okay, I don't give the definition, but there is a vertex algebra, which is a kind of lifting of cotangent bundle. So, okay, I write like that. So you can think of the affine version of the algebra of different operator or differential operators on G, and here the associated variety is just a cotangent bundle of your group G, which is symplectic, and this one appears at each branch in some theories, for instance. And also, intersect with Slodovich slice, not exactly like that, but equivalent. So there are more examples like this.
Any more questions? Thanks again.